Just real thrilled for everyone to be joining us today for another one of our Nursing Leadership Lecture Series. Today we have one of our very first Distinguished Hall of Fame alumni, Dr. Cinda Rushton. She earned her BSN from us in 1978, all the way from Pikeville, Kentucky to Lexington, and has made it to full professor tenure, endowed professor at Johns Hopkins University. So, welcome, Cinda.
Thank you. It's a joy to be here.
I've got a few questions for you.
Okay.
So the first one is, when did you first know you wanted to be a nurse? Would you just share that story?
Well, I think I always knew I wanted to be a nurse. From the time I was probably about 12, I didn't think about doing anything else. I started out working at our doctor's office on the weekends, filling pill boxes and cleaning glass syringes. Doesn't that make me sound really old? And I was just enthused about what was going on in the office. So when I was in high school, they started a program to train students to be nursing assistants. So I took that program like my junior year, and then I started working as a nursing assistant from the summer after my junior year, and I worked all through the time I was here at UK.
So
as a nurse
in Pikeville, you're working there now?
No, I lived in Michigan
at that time,
and so I worked all the rest of my time through high school and then came to UK, and I never considered anything else. It was just what I was going to do. I looked left, looked right, that was it.
And there was not anyone in medicine in your family,
nobody,
right?
No one in my family had done anything in medicine. It was just what I felt like I was called to do.
Good. All right, here comes another question now. So what nursing career advice do you give aspiring nurse leaders? Maybe some tips for success that's helped you be successful. Maybe you can give us three sound tips.
Well, there's a lot of things I could say. One is, I think you really have to be who you are and to follow your passion. That is the fuel for innovation. It's the fuel for satisfaction. And it really makes a difference when you're doing something you really are committed to. I think another one is to trust the process. I think many times we have this idea that there's some grand plan for how one should approach their career. I never had a grand plan. Things just evolved. And I kept saying yes. When the doors opened, I said yes, and I did the next thing. I didn't have any idea where I'd end up or what I'd be doing. It's totally a surprise to me what I'm doing.
Well, it's great. So I have to ask this question. Do you think that that philosophy works in research-intensive environments, and can you still navigate with that principle in academic medicine and academic nursing?
I actually think you can. I think that when there's alignment between your purpose and what you're doing, that resources will show up. And that's not to say that you don't have to, have some kind of idea about where you want to go next. But I think what happens a lot of times is people are chasing the funding source rather than their passion. And I think it in the process can create a lot of stress. Mm-hmm. So I think it's probably a combination of both and. But at the same time, I also think that we need to expand our ways of thinking about how we measure impact and scholarship and how that gets incorporated into the standards that we apply to people who are in research-intensive organizations. The funding sources are changing. Mm-hmm. We have to think differently about how do we do the important work that we need to do, who are our partners, who might be unlikely funders of the work that we're doing, so that we don't get ourselves so boxed into only one path. Because in the end, we need a lot of innovation in our profession. We need to be able to think outside the box, and we need to also celebrate all of the contributions of the diverse profession that we have.
So it sounds like you are a proponent of some of the national movement that's going on with the American Association of Colleges of Nursing about redefining scholarship and what that means for our nursing profession.
I think that it feels to me that when we become so rigid and singular in focus, that we can inadvertently give the message that there's only one way to be successful. I don't happen to believe that. I'm a pretty good example of that. I don't think that I've actually followed the traditional path, and yet I'm certain that I've had a significant impact. And so I've been fortunate to be in an environment where I've been able to do that. And I think we need more innovation. I think we need more people who are not doing the same thing, because actually our strength is in our diversity.
That's great. Okay, let me ask you a really hard question now.
Okay.
So what keeps you up at night? What do you worry about in academic nursing, and as a leader, as a scholar? What are you worried about?
So the things I'm worried about as an academic leader relate to how we are preparing the next generation of nurses and the complexity of what they are going to have to confront. I think that our methods of how we teach, how we think about learning, need to be re-examined. We have more students who are coming into nursing with degrees in something else, who have life experience, and we need to find ways to leverage that to really strengthen our profession rather than to dismiss or discredit it. I worry a lot about how well nurses are prepared to deal with the ethical issues that are part of everyday practice. Many of them are unable to define what their values are and what they stand for, and I think without a very strong moral compass, that the future is going to be difficult, because I don't think the challenges are going to decrease. I think they're only going to intensify. And if nurses don't have those skills and tools, they could end up being kind of rudderless in the process, and that could cause a lot of moral distress, more than they're currently experiencing. So I worry about that, and also just the broader societal economic context of how we think about health and healthcare in this country. Has a huge implication on how nurses will practice. And I think we have to absolutely stay engaged in that national conversation about the implications of policies on the people we serve. That we're in a great position to make those faceless policy decisions have real people associated with them. And I think that's an opportunity, but I think we have to be in that conversation.
So what advice or what thoughts do you have for educators and academic leaders, deans, about the mental health of our students today and the stress that we're seeing when they come into our rigorous programs of study already stressed with perhaps some mental health concerns, and then they make it through the program, they go into these work environments that are incredibly stressful. What do we need to start doing? What would you recommend? If you were to kind of, you know, wave your magic wand, day one, what should we start doing with our students, our nursing students?
Well, I think we have to take seriously that self-stewardship is absolutely essential part of nursing. And our ANA Code of Ethics is really clear about that. The nurse has the same duties to self as to others, including preserving their integrity and well-being. So there's, you know, how do we give the skills and tools that students need to be able to be whole at the end of our programs and while they're progressing through them? And I think we need to help them to design their own personal resilience plan from day one. At the same time, our faculty also need to embody that same commitment, because sometimes what happens is
of self-stewardships and resiliency plan.
That if the faculty don't embody the same commitment, what happens is students don't take it seriously. They look at us and they say, but look at you. So I think there's and I think that, you know, being in academia is a stressful environment as well. So we all would benefit from investing in those kinds of skills. I also think it's important to think about in terms of how the School of Nursing is structured, where there are sacred spaces where people can actually come and get renewal and to get nourishment.
Okay.
That needs to be part of the commitment, as well as having a whole variety of offerings for people to choose which one might actually serve them and their own well-being. And to think about how to infuse that across the curriculum. It's not like it's a lecture in the first semester. It should be integrated throughout the whole curriculum, and those skills reinforced in the clinical area, in our classrooms, how we do business.
I love it. So this is my last question. If you were to pick one historic legend, non-nurse, to have lunch or dinner with, who would it be and why?
So right this moment, if I had the opportunity, I would have lunch with Leland Kaiser.
And Leland is who?
Leland Kaiser is a healthcare futurist who was my Robert Wood Johnson Nurse Executive Fellow mentor. And he is one of the wisest people I've ever known. And I think would have a lot of wisdom to share in the current environment. When I was a fellow back in 2006 and just 2009, his message was that the next era was about feminine leadership.
Oh, really? Is he still alive?
He is. He's.
Are you serious? When did he make that?
2006, 2009. So I think that in the midst of all the chaos.
Me too movement, yes, yes.
That I think it's a really important time to pause and look at whether the previous models for leadership serve us any longer and what might be the alternative.
Okay, I said that was my last question, but now let's just flip it just a little bit. A nurse legend, and it could be someone that perhaps is not living any longer. Who would you like to spend some time with?
I would like to actually spend some time with Isabel Hampton Robb.
Now, this is another person I don't know. Who is this?
So, Isabel Hampton Robb was the first superintendent at Johns Hopkins. She wrote the very first nursing ethics textbook in the United States.
Oh, okay.
And she was like Florence Nightingale, way before her time in terms of how she was thinking about nursing and the things that she was thinking about. So I would love to have a conversation with her about the state of nursing and see what her response would be about where we are and where we might be going.
I love it. Cindy, it's just been a real pleasure having you here.